Good morning. This is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I'll focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. You can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota 57101. I'll be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that's an accurate translation of God's Word into modern English. And let's begin today with Psalm 81. Sing aloud to God our strength. Shout for joy to the God of Jacob. Raise a song, sound the tambourine, the sweet lyre with the harp, blow the trumpet at the new moon, at the full moon on our festal day. For it is a statute for Israel, an ordinance of the God of Jacob. He made it a decree in Joseph when he went out over the land of Egypt. I hear a voice I had not known. I relieved your shoulder of the burden. Your hands were freed from the basket. In distress you called and I rescued you. I answered you in the secret place of thunder. I tested you at the waters of Meribah. Hear, O my people, while I admonish you, O Israel, if you would but listen to me. There shall be no strange god among you. You shall not bow down to a foreign god. I am the Lord your God, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt. Open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. But my people did not listen to my voice. Israel would not submit to me, so I gave them over to their stubborn hearts to follow their own counsels. Oh, that my people would listen to me, that Israel would walk in my ways. Then I would quickly subdue their enemies and turn my hand against their foes. Those who hate the Lord would cringe before him, and their doom would last forever. I would feed you with the finest of wheat, and with honey from the rock I would satisfy you. Those are God's words from Psalm 81. Our musical guest today is Michelle Toombs.
See the light.
That was Michelle Toombs. We'll hear from her again at the end of the program. Stay tuned for that. Turn with me as we look to part of the Sermon on the Mount from Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. That's Matthew chapter 5, 13 through 20. And here Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter, will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Those are God's words from Jesus in Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. Do you ever watch cartoons? I do. I especially like Looney Tunes cartoons, you know? The ones with Bugs Bunny, Daffy Duck, and Elmer Fudd. And oh, how many times we have seen the same routine used on those cartoons. One of the bad guys, usually Yosemite Sam or Elmer Fudd, will be chasing Bugs and run into a dark cave or a basement or a ship's hold, whatever, as long as it is dark. So as Yosemite Sam stumbles around in the dark, he suddenly gets a bright idea. He will light a match and spread some light on that darkness. And you do remember what he discovers when that match flares to life? Of course you do. The dark place is filled with dynamite. The match ignites the powder, and sure enough, a huge explosion happens. And as can only happen in the cartoons, the bad guy is left standing there all black-faced, with several of his teeth hanging loosely from his shocked-looking face. Yes, the light shined into the darkness, and everything changed. Well, in our passage for today, we see some of Jesus' great Sermon on the Mount teachings. Now, the Sermon on the Mount is recorded in Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7. It is a great message from Jesus, our Master and Messiah. But sadly, there is a rather large amount of confusion about how to apply the Sermon on the Mount. President Harry Truman once stated in a public speech, "All the ills of the world can be addressed by a proper application of the principles outlined in the Sermon on the Mount." And therein is discovered the conundrum. How do we properly apply the principles of the Sermon on the Mount? Well, let me briefly discuss some common misunderstandings and incorrect ways of dealing with the teachings Jesus gave in his Sermon on the Mount. First is the erroneous concept that somehow Matthew invented this material. That is just bogus. Matthew was a tax collector, he was literate, and he probably made notes during the actual presentation of these materials. So when we read Matthew's gospel, we can rest assured that it is the actual words given by Jesus, a translation of the original. But some might protest that the materials in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7, it differs from what Luke recorded in his gospel in Luke chapter 6. And there are some differences, but this does not mean that they are in conflict with each other or that Matthew or Luke made up materials. Rather, what it does mean is that Jesus preached various different sermons and that they were sometimes varying from one to another. I know that in my own life, I have preached very similar sermons at different churches. And should they be laid side by side, there would be subtle differences, but essentially they were the same. So too with Jesus. Matthew recorded one sermon, Luke recorded another. For remember, Matthew wrote in Matthew 4:23, "Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness among the people. Jesus preached many different sermons. Luke has one, Matthew has another. They're similar, but different. Another wrong idea about the Sermon on the Mount is that it is for individuals only, and not for society. Well, society is just a group of individuals. As any school child should have learned, we as a society are of the people, by the people, and for the people. And we are one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. A group or society is only as moral as the morality of the individuals who make up that group. There are not two standards, one for individuals and another for groups. Rather, sin must be rejected, whether it is done by individuals or by individuals leading groups. The concept that society can be run under different standards, one for individuals and one for society, that was part of what the factors behind the rise of fascism in Nazi Germany. The typical German Christian was deceived into believing that there were separate kingdoms, one for individuals and one for society. And the outcome of that deception was mass murder for millions of people and world war. A similar misunderstanding is that the Sermon on the Mount represents a vision of what it is like in heaven, but does not apply to earth. Well, that view is also wrong, for Jesus dismantled that argument when he stated that we should pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven." That is part of the Lord's Prayer and is found in the Sermon on the Mount. It's found in Matthew chapter 6, verse 10. So we see that a proper understanding of the Sermon on the Mount is that it is the true and accurate recording of Jesus' message, and that it does apply to all parts of life, now and for the future. So today, I want to ask you a profound question. Will you be a dim bulb or a searchlight? Yes, you heard me correctly. Are you a dim bulb or a searchlight? In our passage for today, Jesus states, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot." Now, it would be great to explore all the ways Christians can be like salt. We should be zesty and flavorful and serve as a preservative for society. But that will need to wait for another time. For I want to look at light today. For Jesus said, "You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid." What did he mean? How important is light? Well, when my daughter Chelsea was born, she was a bit premature. She needed to be under special bilirubin lights that promoted healing and gave her better health. Indeed, light is powerful. And do you appreciate having electrical lights in your home? Well, recently our home lost electrical power. Now, usually when the power goes out, it's only for a short time. But this time it was for a longer period. The power was out for about 6 hours. Now, this happened at about 5:30 in the afternoon, and it was dark outside. It was dark inside. It was dark. One of the first things my daughter said to me was, "Dad, don't you go falling down the stairs." Well, I did not fall down the stairs, but there was that long walk through the dark house to try to find the flashlight. Well, I found the flashlight, and then we rounded up some candles and got light. It was kind of a fun time as we sat around and talked without the disturbance of modern conveniences. And this evening without power also got me to thinking about the importance of light. And consider, it seems to me that the person who can control the flow of electricity could control a modern society. You know, with the cost of electrical power going up, I've heard some people speculate that maybe on the East Coast they should shut off 30% of the lighthouses at night so they could save money. Are you one of those people who can remember back to when electrical connections first came to your home? Perhaps you remember your parents or grandparents telling you about the major change that happened when rural electric came through and connection was established? An elderly person that I know told me about the light plant that operated in his hometown when he was younger. He told me that this light plant would shut down at about 10 in the evening, and thus no one would have electricity through the night. That was the typical way things operated. Well, he did say that you could talk to the people who ran the light plant, and they would keep the power going for a few more hours if you were hosting a party or something. Yes, how the world has changed since electrical service has become widespread to spread light. But way back when Jesus spoke those great words saying, "You are the light of the world," there was not electrical supply. There was no way to harness electricity. But ancient people still needed to light up their world. They had bonfires and cooking fires, and there were small oil-powered lamps. These lamps are what Jesus referred to when he said, "No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house." The kind of lamps which Jesus talks about were probably small pottery bowls that were fashioned into having a sort of a flared end. And in this end was placed a wick, and the bowl was filled with oil, usually olive oil. The wick was then lit, and the lamp gave light. The lamp could then be placed on a stand, and light would spread throughout that room. Now, when Jesus comments, "No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket," it really is rather humorous comment. For picture it in your mind. An open flame burning out of the end of a flared bowl. And then take a wicker basket and set it down over that open flame. Do you get the picture? An open flame lamp would not be a safe thing to put under a wicker basket. For if you did, the wicker basket would ignite and the flames would burn out of control. It would be catastrophic. That would be like Yosemite Sam lighting up the match in the room filled with dynamite. On two other occasions, Jesus used humorous images to get his points across. In Luke 8:16, we read, "No one, after lighting a lamp, hides it under a jar or puts it under a bed, but puts it on a lampstand so that those who enter may see the light." And again in Luke 11:33, Jesus said, "No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it in a cellar, but on a lampstand so that those who enter may see the light." People of all ages need light. In fact, all of life on earth is dependent upon sunlight. And Jesus, our Master and Messiah, used the metaphor of light to show how people should be in life. In fact, Jesus claimed that he is the source of all light. In John 8:12, we read, "Again, Jesus spoke to them, saying, 'I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life.'" In the Bible, the image of light is often used to describe a searching or a self-examination. In Psalm 119:105, we read, "Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." And again in 2 Peter 1:19, we read, "So we have the prophetic message more fully confirmed. You will do well to be attentive to this as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts." And in Psalm 18:28, we read, "It is you who light my lamp. The Lord my God lights up my darkness." So let me ask you again, and seriously consider, are you a dim bulb or are you a searchlight? How can people be a light to the world? Well, it starts off with being in touch with our sinful nature. For as sinners, our lights cannot shine, nor can we ever light up anything as a sinner. As we read in Job 18:5, "Surely the light of the wicked is put out, and the flame of their fire does not shine." And again in Job chapter 38, verse 15, "Light is withheld from the wicked, and their uplifted arm is broken." And then a profound comment is heard in Proverbs 13:9. "The light of the righteous rejoices, but the lamp of the wicked goes out." So as sinners, we are surrounded in darkness. The darkness of sin is far blacker than any night without power. The darkness of sin is far more damaging than any cartoonish explosion. Yes, the blackness and darkness of sin can be for eternal. But we are not trapped in that sin. We are not void of light. No, indeed. For Jesus has come to set us free. The light shines in the darkness and rescues us. Jesus will save us and light up our lives when we confess our sins and seek to love Jesus with all our hearts and souls and minds. That is how we become lights to the world. We shine as Jesus' love flows through us into the world. And not only do we shine in our words, but our actions are vital as well. As we remember from 1 John 3:18, little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in truth and action. The great evangelist Phillips Brooks told a story about how a primitive tribe was given the gift of a sundial. They were so impressed by this gift that they built a special house to keep it in and hold it safe. Unfortunately, the house had a solid roof over the top, and this was not good for the sundial. For when the light is cut off, the value of a sundial goes way down. By hiding away the sundial, it was rendered useless. Are we as Christians like that? Have we covered over our lights and hidden them inside our houses of worship? Have we become dim bulbs? So as we give our lives to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we get plugged in. Jesus told us in agricultural terms about how vital is our connection to Him. In John 15:5, we read Jesus saying, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing." Well, let's put that in a modern phrase, shall we? Jesus might say to us, "I am the electrical power plant, and you are the high power lines to the world. If you are flowing with the electrical power of my love, then the lights of the world will burn brightly. But without being connected to me, you can do nothing." As Christians, we are the recipients of God's blessed mercy and grace. Will we appreciate that, or just sit back and do nothing? So are you a dim bulb or a searchlight? Jesus said in our passage for today, "Let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." Let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Will you be a searchlight burning through the darkness of evil and sorrow to shine the light of God's love on people? Will your good deeds so light up everywhere you go that people will notice that the light has come on and Jesus is in the building? As Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians 4:6, "For it is God who said, 'Let light shine out of darkness,' who has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ." Will you be so much of an influence in your world that there will be an explosion of light, love, mercy, and grace? Or are you just a meaninglessly dim bulb? Are you something no one pays attention to? The choice is yours. Jesus has the power all turned on and ready to zap into your searchlight. Are you willing to shine? Or would you rather be a broken light bulb just hanging around waiting to be changed? In the cartoons, at least Yosemite Sam does something when he's fumbling around in the dark. He strikes a match and lets a light shine, and everything changes. And that's just in the cartoons. What can happen in real life is even greater. Consider what would happen if every Christian would turn on the full power of Christ's light and shine into the world. Remember, cockroaches run for cover when the lights come on. I believe that the people from, say, 10 miles away would still see the glow of a Christian who truly loves Jesus and seeks to be a conduit of God's love. There would be a mighty revival, a shout to heaven, and the globe would change. Every social ill in our society can only be addressed adequately by Christians shining the light of God's love into the world. Hunger, for example, can only be addressed when Christians shine like searchlights and show the good deeds of feeding the hungry to the world. The light from Christian searchlights would expose the sins of greed and gluttony, which significantly affect the problem of hunger. The problem of abortion can only be addressed when Christians shine like searchlights, illuminating the hearts and minds of the people in the world to see that children are valuable and wanted and need to be protected. The problem of violence can only be addressed when Christians shine brightly and show the world that Jesus is the Prince of Peace who offers a better way. And every other social ill is the same way. For they all start in the darkness of a human heart. A dark and lost heart cannot shine at all. Christians need to be sharing the love of Jesus with others so that they can repent from sin, become Christians, and start to shine. Millions of Christians shining as cities on the hills, all across God's green earth, have the power and ability to bring revival to the lost, justice to the oppressed, and hope to the disparaging. But it starts with each individual believer. Will you be the first one to strike a match and light up everything and change your world? I'm John Thornton. Thanks for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and light up your world. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches of various denominations. You can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota 57101. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. We'll finish today with Michelle Toombs.
There's a dream in your heart.